tell me that it's evolution. Gentlemen of the National Assembly, feudalism is abolished. I find it necessary to make our feelings known to the French people, lest we become as disjointed from them as the previous regime. It must be recognized that all men are born and remain equal. There are certain inalienable rights possessed by everyone. Liberty and property cannot be taken away. The security of knowing that the government exists solely to protect both of these is essential. And if a governing body overreaches its bounds, the people have a right to resist oppression. Today, on this August the 26th, I say we shall declare the rights of every man and citizen to all the world.
And so the Declaration of the Rights of Man and Citizen was issued by the National Assembly on August 26, 1789. It was reproduced in thousands of leaflets, pamphlets, and books, and was soon translated and spread throughout Europe. Though the word man is used, in the original French, both man and citizen were used in a way that is taken to include both genders, acknowledging the important role of women in the French Revolution, though at the time they were still considered legally inferior to men. Shortly after the adoption of the Declaration, leadership in the National Assembly split over what form the new government would take.
I want a five-camera legislator with a strong veto power for the king. They've got one in England.
Who needs England? Where's your patriotism? We got to have a unicameral legislator. If we create an upper house, then some of us will have to volunteer to reside in the lower house. And I'm sure the upper house would get uppity and declare themselves nobility anyway. And why would you give the king veto power? That invalid will veto anything not involving bringing him a donut. If anything, he should only be allowed to delay legislation.
I guess you're right. I would hate for the king to get enough power to agitate our neighbors to start a counter-revolution anyway.
I hate to ruin the ending, but I'm going to anyway. In the end, the Patriots got their unicameral legislature and suspensive veto for the king.
I think you're both taking too long!
On October 4th, 1789, a large group of women, followed by a Parisian National Guard, invaded Versailles.
Let's get 'em, girls!
After being captured by the angriest mob of women, this side of the first Black Friday when Tickle Me Elmo was sold, the royal family was moved to Paris, where they could be watched and forced to cooperate. Meanwhile, the new government set about separating itself from the old regime and eventually the initial supporters of the revolution.
Alright guys, let's get some ideas. Anybody?
Let's divide the country into 83 departments so that we don't have any power outside of Paris.
I like it. What else?
Ooh, let's plan labor unions. They only cause trouble. And let's differentiate between passive citizens and active citizens. They'll both have the same civil rights, but we'll only let the active citizens vote.
Yeah, you can't read, you can't vote. That's what my dear old mom used to say.
Okay. But how are we going to afford to keep the government running when we already owe the bourgeoisies?
Let's just take everything away from the church and auction it off. After that, we can organize a national church.
Yeah, we can make all of the priests elected officials and assign one bishop to each department.
But wouldn't that anger the Catholics? They might turn against us.
Who cares? They should remember that they're French first and Catholic second.
Unfortunately for Constituent 3, many Catholics were indeed upset by the new civil constitution of the church. Many chose to worship clandestinely with refractory priests instead. All this change didn't set well with the royal family still being held in Paris. In June 1791, they tried to escape France so they could seek foreign aid.
Action. No, I do not like being stuck here in Paris.
Blah, blah, blah. All talk and no walk. Talk and gloom and listen.
Well, of course not. However, I will call for a carriage.
The royal family nearly escaped to Austria, and Louis, in his infinite wisdom, chose to leave a note detailing his contempt for the revolution. Unfortunately for him, they were stopped at Varennes and arrested and taken back to Paris.
I just received great news! We defeated the Prussians at Valmy. They've ceased their march on Paris.
That is great news. Today is a new beginning. It is the first day of year one of the French Republic.
A few months later, in December.
Next order of business, bring the king out.
Louis XVI.
Your Majesty, you have been accused of high treason. What do you guys think?
1 month later.
All right, Your Majesty, we've made our decision. It has been decided unanimously that you are guilty. You will be executed by guillotine as soon as possible.
Dang. I mean, chocolat bleu.
And so Lou was executed on January 21st, 1793. The date was also notable as the most profitable day in history for French popcorn vendors. Historians have always suspected, but have never been able to prove a correlation. Shortly afterward, the most prominent French general, Dumouriez, defected to Austria, sending a wave of panic across France.
This is horrible!
What do you suggest we do? Marat, do you have any ideas?
I'm in the bathroom! Fill me in later, guys!
We must enforce strict precautions to strike terror into the hearts of our would-be enemies.
But what should we call such a program?
How about the terror?
That's genius.
Yes, and we'll appoint the Committee of Public Safety to run the program. We'll have to be able to bring anyone we suspect, and we'll set up a revolutionary tribunal to decide the fates of our enemies.
I'll go polish the guillotine.
With the so-called Reign of Terror underway, nearly 25 people a day were guillotined, including the former queen. Marat continued to publish his newspaper, encouraging the violence around him until he received an unexpected visitor.
Rubber ducky, you're the one. You make bath time so much fun.
Come in! Oh, and how may I help you, young lady?
My name is Charlotte Corday, and through your hate speech, you indirectly killed my father and a bunch of other people. Prepare to die.
And then there were two. With all the violence, people began looking for someone to blame. The Jacobins directed the public's anger against the Girondins and sent them to the guillotine. Even so, not all was well within the Jacobins.
Maxie, I've been thinking.
Oh, really? Did it hurt?
Only a little at first. But anyway, don't you think the violence has gone on long enough?
As a matter of fact, I don't. Guards!
With most of his friends and all of his enemies beheaded, Robespierre was running out of people to suspect of being counter-revolutionaries. After taking a short break to appear as Liberty herself at the Festival of the Cult of the Supreme Being, and to remove any doubt that he had lost his mind, Maximilian Robespierre announced to the National Convention that he had a list of names of traitors, some of whom he said were to be members of the National Convention.
I have a list of names of traitors to the revolution here in my pocket. However, I will decide tonight whether or not I will read it tomorrow morning.
I've had enough of this. This guy's definitely off his rocker.
I agree. I propose we have him beheaded before he can do any more damage. All in favor?
Aye!
Yar!
Bang!
It seems I've made a tactical error.
With the beheading of Robespierre, the Reign of Terror finally came to an end.
Yeah! Rubber ducky, you're the one!
1, 2, 3, 4! Rubber ducky, you're so much fun! You know, bath time so much fun! Rubber ducky, I'm awfully fond of you!